If you want to move up, you can. If you're comfortable where you are, that's fine. We're going to begin with another patient's story, and then she will introduce the doctors. So welcome, Christine Garrott.
Good afternoon. I'd like to very thank the MBCN team for inviting me to share a little bit of my story and to invite to welcome our next set of lecturers. I was diagnosed originally in February of 2013. I had had a negative mammogram the July before. I found the lesion myself, and by the time we got through the diagnosis process, I was told that I had stage 3C of invasive lobular cancer. I went through the typical process. I had surgery, I had chemo, I had radiation. I finished all that the Monday before Thanksgiving of last year, and I had the best holiday season ever. Thinking all was well. I started to search for work. I had been out of work and out of health insurance for many months prior to that. Went back to search for work, and I actually had a job interview and then was made an offer, and I was supposed to start on the 24th of March of this year. I decided I'm going to go and see all my doctors because Lord knows they won't let me go to the ladies' room after I get to this new job, nonetheless go to a doctor's appointment for a while. And in the course of things, I had a series of lab tests done because I was about ready for that. And then I got a phone call. And my oncologist, whom I love, said to me, "I don't even know how to say this to you." And I said, "Bob, just say it." And he said, "Your tumor markers are elevated." And I said, "What's your gut?" He said, "My gut is we have something going on. We best go find it." And 3 days prior to me starting this brand new job, I learned that I had metastatic disease to the bone. And I walked away from that new job because it was not fair to these new employers to gain a brand new employee with such a huge baggage attached. And it wasn't fair to me to be the person that they expected me to be and be the patient I needed to be. And I walked away from that job opportunity. I've had many, many blessings in this journey, both in the first time and the second. I've met extraordinary people, done extraordinary things, and I'm extremely blessed from it. So I'm here to tell you that it is not all of a negative journey. There are blessings to be had. All you need to do is open your eyes and open the doors. Before I introduce our speakers, I just want to give you a gentle reminder that if you have questions during their presentation, to please use the index cards that are in your folders to write them down. Someone will come and get them. We'll have a Q&A session to participate in right following this talk. I'd like to take the opportunity to introduce our next speakers. Dr. Carrie K. Anders is a clinician scientist and an associate professor of medicine at the University of North Carolina School of Medicine, a member of both the UNC Lineberger Comprehensive Cancer Center and the UNC Breast Center, co-director of the Multidisciplinary Brain Metastases Clinic at UNC, and the leader of the UNC Breast Cancer Clinical Trials Program. Dr. Anders' research focuses on the biology of triple-negative breast cancer and brain metastases. She serves as the principal investigator for multiple clinical trials, evaluating novel anti-cancer agents to more effectively treat patients with advanced triple-negative breast cancer and brain metastases. In parallel and supported by the UNC Chapel Hill Hematology Oncology K-12, NIH NCI K-23, and Damon Runyon Clinical Investigator Award, she has developed multiple intracranial breast cancer tumor models to test novel therapies, including small molecule and nanoparticle chemotherapeutics in the laboratory. Her ultimate goal is to uncover genetic and genomic underpinnings of triple-negative breast cancer and brain metastases, with the goal of translating findings into rationally designed therapeutics to treat this aggressive disease. Dr. Timothy Zagar is an assistant professor of radiation oncology. His research interests focus on agents that enhance the effectiveness of radiation treatment, including chemotherapy and hyperthermia. He is a member of the UNC Breast Center and the Multidisciplinary Thoracic Oncology Program. Dr. Zagar graduated magna cum laude from Georgetown University and earned his MD from Mount Sinai School of Medicine. He completed his radiation oncology residency at Duke University. Please join me in warmly welcoming our next speakers.
Wonderful. This is quite a large room for a small group session, but I think we'll make the best of it. Today we've talked a lot about metastasis, and this, which is a topic I think we're all interested in learning more about, not only from the biology perspective, but also the treatment perspective. But this session is specifically devoted to bone metastasis. So, we've taken this in a twofold approach because, as it turns out, not just one of the physicians is responsible for treating bone metastasis. It really is a multidisciplinary effort. I think the one group we don't have represented here is orthopedic surgery, but I believe Dr. Zagar will touch on some of that during his local therapy discussion. So I'm going to begin from the medical oncology perspective and talk about what bone metastases are and what complications may arise, and also how bone metastases might differ. The incidence may differ by breast cancer subtype. I think many of you heard Dr. Carey's presentation, and we all know in this room that breast cancer is not just one disease process. And then I'll spend the first half of the talk really discussing the medical management of bone metastasis. And we'll talk a lot about bisphosphonates as well as RANK ligand inhibitors. And then I'll turn over the podium to Dr. Zagar, who's going to talk about more about local therapy to bone metastasis, particularly radiation therapy and focused radiation, including CyberKnife. So what is the definition of bone metastasis? And I find that this is frequently misunderstood, not so much in our clinics, but across the general public. Many people believe when you have bone metastasis, you have bone cancer, and as we know, that is not the case. Bone metastasis, by definition, are a class of cancer metastasis that results from primary tumor invasion into the bone. So this is, as Dr. Carey discussed earlier, breast cancer cells that find their home in the bone, not cells in the bone turning into cancers themselves. Some of the cancers that are primary include osteosarcoma, chondrosarcoma, Ewing sarcoma. These are very rare tumors, and as it turns out, bone metastasis and metastatic breast cancer are quite common. We've talked, of course, we're here to discuss metastatic breast cancer to bone, but many of the other solid tumors that we take care of also metastasize to bone, including lung cancer and prostate cancer. Multiple myeloma is a liquid tumor that also frequently goes to bone. So when we're in the clinic, what tests do we usually think about to diagnose bone metastasis? And it turns out there are quite a few we can use depending on the circumstance. The first one here is a nuclear bone scan, and we find many times that this is confused with a DEXA scan or a bone mineral density scan. And I will tell you, I have had patients where I've ordered a bone scan and gotten a DEXA scan result, and vice versa when I've ordered a DEXA and actually gotten a bone scan result. And that always is an interesting conversation, sometimes more information than we were really looking for. But you'll see the bone scan is actually here over to the right, and this is a total body scan, a radionucleotide test, where we see bone metastasis light up with the dark spots here in the skeleton. The other test we can use is a PET scan. And I am certain that many of you in the room have experienced a PET scan for staging purposes. And this is where we look at glucose uptake or cells that are most metabolically active. And in this case, you can see a bone metastasis lighting up here on a PET scan. And then finally, good old plain x-rays are actually quite good for looking at bone metastasis. And you'll see here, it's not the greatest resolution, but in general, the spinal, this is the spinal column. These vertebrae should be nice and homogeneous, and you can see these heterogeneous sort of moth-eaten looks within the bone, which we can see on radiograph. That's also very helpful to see if there is fracture associated with bone metastasis. But I think these scans are all well and good, but I have to say, and in my own practice, I would never tell a woman that they have metastatic breast cancer based on one of these scans. I would require a fine needle aspiration to really know what we're seeing and a biopsy under the microscope to diagnose what cells are actually residing in the bone. So what about symptoms related to bone metastasis? Well, there are many. I think the first that we worry about is pain and discomfort. And that's certainly the goal of treating bone metastasis, as well as ridding the bone of the tumor cells, but treating the symptoms that the cancer cells in the bone are causing. With cancer cells residing in the bone, we can see elevations in calcium levels, pathologic fractures, and this is an example of an arm fracture. This is actually the shoulder and the humerus here, and you can see this fracture right through a bone metastasis because these areas of bone are much weaker than normal bone. Other things we worry about are compromise of the vertebral bodies into the spinal canal in close proximity to the spinal cord, and that can certainly cause dysfunction below the level of the lesion, and that's certainly an issue that we take very seriously in the setting of new back pain or unrelenting back pain in the setting of bone metastasis. And then all of these things can lead to decreased mobility, and I think we've gotten a very nice theme today about self-care and exercise and keeping our bodies as healthy as possible. So we want to prevent many of these things so we can increase mobility. So what about breast cancer subtype? And I think this is also a slide that Dr. Carey had shown earlier in the day, and now that she's educated you on all the different subtypes of breast cancer, this makes my job easier. So this was a very interesting study that was published back in 2009, and essentially here you've got all these genes, as she discussed, and each of the breast cancers in this study were categorized as luminals, which are more commonly our estrogen receptor positive breast cancers, HER2 enriched or HER2 positive. There's this normal-like, which we're still trying to sort out, and then basal, which is triple negative. So what you'll see is on the right-hand side of the slide, the sites where these different breast cancers metastasized, and these are common areas of metastasis for breast cancer. So bone, lung, liver, brain, around the lung and the pleura. And you'll see this light blue tick mark is much more common in the estrogen receptor positive or luminal breast cancers. But it's not to say that patients with HER2 positive metastatic breast cancer can't have bone metastasis, it's just a less common event, as well as in the basal or triple negative. So now to a little science. I can't give a talk without any research presentation without talking about science, but I promise this will be well understood. So Dr. Zagar and I, as we were putting these together, realized we have good guys and bad guys on this slide. So we're going to think of the osteoblast as the good guys, right? These are the ones that build healthy bone, and this is what we all have in our bodies, and they help keep our bones healthy and turn over. But the problem is that in that process, we have osteoclasts, which are the bad guys. So they come in and break down the bone. And in the setting of malignancy, that is what we are worried about. We're seeing cells that are facilitating breakdown of bone more so than building bone. So there's an imbalance. And then you have RANK ligand. And what RANK ligand does is it partners with the osteoclast, so also a bad guy, to come in and break down bone. So we have this kind of yin and yang. And in the setting of metastasis, the osteoclast, RANK ligand, are elevated above that of the good cells or osteoblast. And this will make sense as we go through to see why we use certain drugs that work on either osteoblast, osteoclast, or RANK ligand. So of the agents that I use in clinic as a medical oncologist, one of the most common ones is a bisphosphonate. And this is the drug that Sally Field, you know, touts on the Boniva commercials and looks so beautiful because she takes Boniva. I think that's where most of my patients have been introduced to that agent. But bisphosphonates are drugs that actually block the osteoclast activity. So they block the breakdown of bone to help build healthier bone. There's a much newer group of therapeutics called RANK ligand inhibitors. And again, these are the partners with the osteoclast. So you're hitting the breakdown of bone at a different angle. And then in addition, we can't forget symptom management or pain management. So NSAIDs can be very effective in bone-related pain. They decrease inflammation, acetaminophen for pain itself. And many times we do need to go to narcotic medications to help with the symptoms of bone metastasis. There we go. So here's a list of many of the bisphosphonates that are FDA approved in the United States. And I will say the large majority of literature in bone metastasis has been performed with Zometa. I do have patients in my practice who are not on Zometa, many times just for lifestyle because they really don't want to come into the infusion room to receive an IV infusion. They may not have a port at this stage in their disease and frankly just want to stay out of the infusion room. So many times we will go to an oral bisphosphonate, of which there are several FDA approved here in the United States. And the data to support the use of bisphosphonates is quite strong and has been shown not only in breast cancer but other solid tumors that develop bone metastasis. So this was one of the seminal studies back in 2003, over a decade ago, that basically looked at patients who had solid tumor bone metastasis, of which many of these patients were breast and lung cancer patients. And they randomized patients to receive zoledronic acid, which is the generic name for Zometa, 4 milligrams every 3 weeks for 9 months versus placebo. And their primary outcome was interesting. It wasn't survival of patients. It was actually more of a quality of life outcome, which was the proportion of patients to have a skeletal-related event. And they define that as multiple complications that we've already covered. Pathologic fracture, need for radiation to the bone, surgery to the bone, spinal cord compression, and hypercalcemia was also listed. And what they found is that the patients who received zoledronic acid actually did better. So they had decreased occurrences of skeletal-related events. If they did have a skeletal-related event, it was longer down the road in their disease process. But that did come with a side effect profile, which I think can be quite profound. Bone pain, as you can imagine, you're interfering with the balance in the bone resorption and building. There, interestingly, have been some flu-like symptoms, which I think is just a release of inflammatory biomarkers. And one of the things in particular we have to worry about with zoledronic acid is watching kidney function. Although the risk of having kidney dysfunction has been less than 10% in the majority of the studies. So moving on to the RANK ligand inhibitor, so the one that is FDA approved and we currently use in clinic is called denosumab. The trade names in the setting of metastatic breast cancer is Xgeva, and it also has an indication in aromatase inhibitor-induced osteopenia, and that's called Prolia. It has there's a difference in the dosing. But in any case, in the seminal study that identified the efficacy for Xgeva, over 1,000 women were randomized to receive good old zoledronic acid or Zometa, or they received denosumab, and this is delivered subcutaneously every 4 weeks. And again, they looked at occurrence of skeletal-related event, need for radiation to bone, and also quality of life in this study. And in this particular study, all of the outcomes favored denosumab. So occurrence of skeletal-related events, need for radiation to the bone, and there was actually a 10% improvement in quality of life. And I apologize, I don't know which parameter they use for quality of life, but we could certainly go back and look at that if anyone has questions. But again, Xgeva is administered differently. It's a subcutaneous injection. And in terms of the kidney toxicity, it's actually been shown to be a little better than the zoledronic acid. And we don't have to worry as much about baseline differences in kidney function when we're prescribing Xgeva. But we do see, and one thing I've seen in my own practice and have to be very careful about, is the calcium, because it is such a potent hypocalcemic drug, hypocalcemia can be quite problematic, and many times we're having to supplement calcium back a couple days after the receipt of XGEVA. So one thing we worry a lot about with these drugs, they are all well and good, but I think all of these medications can induce side effects. And the one that I personally worry a lot about is osteonecrosis of the jaw. And this has been defined, also known as ONJ, as the jawbone being exposed and basically starving for lack of blood supply based on chronic use of bisphosphonate. The incidence in the majority of studies is 1.6%, but I would have to say in my own practice and across our practices at UNC, we're seeing it more frequently than that. So I think it's important to know about this side effect, to not take jaw pain, you know, not just kind of chalk it up as, oh, maybe I chewed on something differently or I have an infected tooth, but to really be certain that you take this to your doctor and alert them to this. And also, given the fact that the bone remodeling is interfered with many of these medications, it's important to alert your doctor if you have dental procedures coming up, because the healing of the bone many times can be the problem leading to ONJ. So this really leads to one of the things as a medical community we've really been trying to grapple with is we know these drugs are helpful, but maybe too much is not good. And this was a very interesting study called the Zoom study. I don't know why I like the name of this study, but it's just all of these catchy names. So in the Zoom study, patients after 1 year of completing monthly zoledronic acid, which is usually our standard interval, were randomized to receiving the medication every 4 weeks for a year or every 12 weeks for a year, so extending the interval out to every 3 months. And interestingly, the outcomes were quite similar from an efficacy perspective, but there was actually a decline in some of the side effects. So I've changed my practice based on this study and have actually been a little even more creative in some of my long-term survivors who have been on bisphosphonates many times for up to a decade. I've actually gone out to every 6 months or sometimes once a year, depending on the status of their disease. And that really gets to the next point, which is how long should we be continuing these agents? And the answer is, as many of the questions have been this morning, we really don't know. The only guideline we have comes from ASCO, which we do trust and love, but basically it says we continue them as long as they're working. So it doesn't give us great guidance, but it doesn't tell us that, you know, if you've received a bisphosphonate for 2 years, you need to stop. So I think this at least gives us some reassurance that what we're doing is helpful, and we should continue it as long as it is helpful. But we might need to tailor the interval to the patient's individual needs and their disease status. So, you know, I think one of the questions is how do you pick between denosumab and zoledronic acid or a bisphosphonate in general? And I think that's very individualized. I think that, you know, one of the first things is efficacy data. And I will say in full disclosure, I give both zoledronic acid and XGEVA in my practice. I think we do have efficacy data showing that zoledronic acid may have some advantages, but it may not be for everybody. I think thinking about the toxicity profile in the setting of each individual patient is very helpful. What is the patient's renal function? Do they struggle with hypocalcemia at baseline? Well, then XGEVA or denosumab is probably not the right medication. Whether or not the patient is in a place where they'd prefer just to have the infusion along with another infusion and have vascular access that a port or, you know, IV access that's not problematic, or would they rather just get a subcutaneous injection and move on out to the rest of their day? And then again, that kind of comes to the time involved of the administration. So a lot of different factors go into it. And I can't say that I really use one preferentially over the other. It's really individualized. So with that, I will halt from a medical perspective, a medical oncology perspective, and hand over to my partner in crime, Dr. Zagar.
So I will tell you that was her idea to put that picture up.
I didn't want them to miss you, right?
And we're just going to keep looking at it for a few more minutes.
There you go.
So it's an honor and a privilege to be asked to speak with you. I apologize if I repeat some slides. I think you'll see that sometimes we share slides with each other / steal them. So I am a radiation oncologist. Bone mets are my wheelhouse. Unfortunately, they are extremely common. So as a result, we treat a lot of them. Just kind of a an outline. I'm going to talk about what is radiation therapy, how it works, and I think what's really important and what I'm going to spend a lot of time on my talk is how many do I need? How many should I get? And why did you pick that? And then I'll get a little cynical for a minute, too. So just radiation is energy. It's similar to, you know, it's on the same spectrum as microwaves. But what many patients ask is the radiation we use to treat cancer is far stronger than the radiation that you get in your PET scans or your CT scans. It's on the order of kilovoltage, which is 1,000, mega means millions, so it's essentially the same radiation, only much stronger. So that way it can actually penetrate further and cause a lot of damage. Radiation damages DNA, cancer cells can't. Repair it, whereas normal cells can. So nobody really knows why bone mets hurt so bad, for sure. So some people say it's due to microfracture, so that, you know, when cancer cells disrupt the bone, you get microfractures, and a fractured bone hurts. So with time, radiation, if you kill the cancer cells, then the normal body, the osteoblasts and et cetera, they can remodel the bone, and then that's why we think that the pain tends to go away. This is a very busy slide. One of the things that I'm sure is not a surprise to you guys, but sometimes we need to immobilize our patients so that we can treat what we want to treat and avoid what we want to avoid. The reason radiation causes side effects is not because it treats the cancer, it's because it treats the normal tissues in front of the cancer, next to the cancer. So that's why sometimes we need to keep you in, you know, not moving, not that you guys want to move, but, you know, involuntarily sometimes we move. This is an example from a radiation treatment planning software of a very simple way to treat a bone metastasis. This is the right side of a lady's body that I treated as a resident. This is her liver, this is her spleen, stomach, and you can see her vertebral body nicely outlined in red, which is what we do for a living. We do a lot of coloring. I circled this thing that's not supposed to be there. And then if you look at an x-ray, this red thing is not supposed to be there. That's why you hurt, because it's not normal bone there. There's cancer there that has presumably broken down that bone. And this is actually an example of what a radiation field looks like to treat this area. Now, actually, this thought came to me when you were talking, Carrie. So there are two different types of bone mets. There's so-called osteolytic or osteoblastic. Osteoblastic, B means build, so you can have these bones. I stole this slide from a junior resident who doesn't know that this is actually arthritis. This is the bone met. Serves me right for stealing. But this is the bone met. That's arthritis. Bone met, bone met. Osteoblastic. And I can't move it. So, and this is an osteolytic met. So you can see that lytic means break, so this is like a broken down thing. Do you use Xgeva, Carrie, with osteoblastic mets? Okay. So because breast cancer more commonly does osteolytic, but they can also do osteoblastic. But it doesn't make sense to me. I've got to pick your brain later. Okay, but the mechanism of Xgeva is that it stops the osteoclast. So if you have an osteoblastic met, it shouldn't really work, but I guess it does. Okay, anyway, sorry. Okay, all right. There's a bunch of different kinds of radiation that we can give. External beam radiation, that's the kind of, you know, anywhere from 1 to a couple of weeks of treatment for a palliative bone regimen. And when we say palliative, we literally just mean to get rid of pain. I will briefly talk about radiosurgery. If you were in the brain mets talk, sorry, there's going to be some repeat slides. And then the systemic radionuclides, I don't know if anybody knows about these. They're not used that often. They make a lot of sense in certain cases, and we'll talk about them, but it's essentially injectable radiation that is linked to metals, or I guess calcium's in there. Anyway, basically they hone to bone, and they go to bone, and then they release radiation, and I'll talk a little bit more about them. Unfortunately, I'm not going to talk that much about surgery. Surgery is often used in the setting of bone metastases if there's bone instability on weight-bearing bones. So a broken hip or an impending or a hip that's about to break related to cancer routinely gets fixed at our institution, because if you fall and break a hip, then that can be devastating for many reasons. Post-operative complications, you're out of the loop for a while, you can't get chemotherapy, etc. Another site where some type of non-radiation, non-chemo option is in the spine. There are some times that we used, that should be vertebroplasty, sorry about the typo, or kyphoplasty, where a neurosurgeon or an interventional radiologist essentially injects cement or some other alloy or fake wood. They use all different kinds of things to kind of strengthen the bone. This is often helpful with pain relief. All right, so does radiation work? Yes. Just does. I'm done. So did I say that I'm a radiation oncologist? And by the way, I don't know how we followed after Rosenstein. That guy is like a ninja. He's like so soothing. But anyway, so radiation, there was a big review of 20 studies. And the problem when you combine other studies is they all have different definitions of pain relief. They use different doses of radiation, different what we call fractionation schemes. A radiation treatment is, for whatever reason, we refer to it as a fraction. And they have different pain scales, different pain relief. And in reality, the numbers that of these 20 studies published in 2008 actually seem quite low to me. So only a quarter of patients had complete pain relief at 1 month. Half had pain relief at, or 30% had only half of their pain relief. I must say that in my practice, and it's not because I'm a good doctor, but I feel like they're much higher. And in anybody in the room who's had palliative radiation for bone mets, I feel like it's higher than that. But anyway, the most often question I get asked when I'm palliating a bone met with radiation is, when is it going to work? And I wish I was smarter, and I don't have the answer. I will say that some people notice pain relief after the first treatment. Some people within the first week. Some people after the radiation is done. And truth be told, because there is a lot of remodeling of the damaged bone, that sometimes the pain relief can take weeks or months. The worst case is when you get no pain relief. And then you kind of feel really bad about it. So oftentimes what I recommend we do with our patients is when you're in a lot of pain, we lean on the narcotics first, so that, you know, we maximize that while we're doing the radiation, and when after the radiation is done, we then try to wean off the narcotics to see if the radiation had its effect, because nobody wants to be on mega doses of narcotics for a lot of reasons. So here's the deal. How many fractions? How many treatments? This has been studied a lot, and one of the other issues is that there's different pain scales used. So the bottom line is this data is very heterogeneous or dirty, so it's hard to make ends meet. But one of the main questions, well, why doesn't everybody get one treatment or 10 treatments or 20 treatments? The most often reason that we do this is the size of the radiation field. The bigger the radiation field is a surrogate, A, the bigger the cancer you need to treat is, but B, the more normal tissue is in there, okay? So if you have a large spinal metastasis in your lower back and you need to treat a big portion of your spine, we would probably do 10 or 15 more treatments of a smaller dose as opposed to one big one due to all of the small intestine and stomach that's in the field. When that gets treated, you get the nausea, vomiting, diarrhea. So we often limit the amount of treatments based on the size of the field and what normal tissues are there. So this is a very often quoted study that almost 1,000 patients, they basically flipped a coin. And again, it's worth noting that these are not all breast cancer patients, these are all malignancies. Half the patients got one treatment, and this is kind of the way we talk about radiation, 8 gray. And then the other half got 10 treatments, 3 times 10. This is probably the most commonly used palliative regimen in this country. Okay, and the primary outcome was pain relief at 3 months. Any idea do you think there's any difference? 0. Okay, so the amount of pain relief between 1 and 10 was exactly equal. Okay, so then why doesn't everybody get 1? Going to get cynical for a second. So believe it or not, the more radiation treatments you get, the more you can bill. So some people, you heard it here first. So, especially in the community where treatment and reimbursement is directly related to your livelihood, and the more you treat, the more you get, that is often done. The other really, and to be honest, so I work in academia and I don't get reimbursed based on how much I treat, but I often do 300 times 10, and the reason is simple. The retreatment rate was nearly double than the group that got one treatment, okay? And you often hear that adage, oh, you got radiation once, you can't get it again. Most times that's absolutely not true. However, whenever you add another course of radiation, you add more side effects and more potential risk. There were more side effects, though, with the 10 treatments. And I'm not going to get into the biology and the physics behind it, but there was about 10 versus 17% had diarrhea, nausea, or vomiting. The bottom line, though, is that if you invest in time, I think, with 2 weeks of radiation or even a week, sometimes we can give a little bit more and give 1 week instead of two, I just think you get more durable pain relief, okay? And one of the issues that sometimes myself and the medical oncologist fight about is, well, we got to get this patient on to the next chemotherapy. Hurry up and do this quick. And recently we had a patient who I fell prey to that, and there was a little bit too much of her esophagus in the field, and I put her in the hospital because she couldn't swallow because I did it too quickly. I gave her too much radiation per day, and I gave her 5 treatments instead of 10 or 14. You remember her? No, it was my fault. I gave it, but I got bullied by her. She's a bully. So, right. People that know me. All right. So anyway, so what kind of toxicity? Fatigue. Anybody in here that's ever had radiation knows it. You get tired. If it's near the abdomen, you get nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, you can get urinary symptoms. One of the other issues is your blood counts can go down. So as adults, most of our bone cell producing bone marrow is centrally located, kind of in the spine and especially the pelvic girdle or all the pelvic bones. So if you can imagine, if you have a big hip met and I give you 2 weeks of radiation, I can knock out some of your blood counts. So that's something to keep in mind. All right, so radiosurgery, again, duplicate slide, but I stole it from myself, is defined as 1 to 5 treatments. And in fact, we're doing a lot more of this with bone metastases, especially in the retreatment setting, okay? This is different than your normal 1 or 2 weeks of radiation because rather than using 1 or 2 radiation beams, you can use many, many beams. And the reason you use many, many beams is to avoid normal tissue, okay? I showed this in the brain metastasis talk, but essentially you're using several hundred small pencil beam radiation beams all settled or all focused on a certain area so that when they all converge, they're only on that area. So you minimize high dose to normal tissue. I'm not going to do this. So this is an example showing an extremely big right kidney, but that's neither here nor there. I just noticed that. First time. I've given this talk several times. Anyway, so this is a bone met in a lady that I treated. I didn't treat her initially, but she had bone mets from breast cancer. And she had a course of radiation. And a year later, she had worsening pain. Now, the spinal cord is something that radiation oncologists, it's kind of, you have to drink the Kool-Aid. You never want to hurt the spinal cord because a spinal cord injury is paramount. I mean, it's a terrible complication. And we know how much radiation the spinal cord can take before causing paralysis. So rather than just giving another course of standard radiation with a single beam here, this course was 250 beams, and by using so many different beams, we're able to minimize dose to the spinal cord and to this mega kidney, and then retreat this area here. Briefly, in the 40 seconds I have to finish, this is the systemic root. I didn't even put the names of these things on, frankly, because I haven't really used them a lot, so I'm not as familiar with them. Sometimes we prescribe them to patients that have diffuse bone mets. One of the issues, though, is that they can lower blood counts. So some patients with asymptomatic but high-volume bony metastatic disease that we think may cause them to get into trouble in the future, sometimes we use them. The issue, though, is they deplete the bone marrow, often considerably, because they hone to the bone marrow, into the bone, and then they emit radiation. So it's basically IV radiation that goes to the bone and then releases its dose over a short period of time. So there's not a lot of nausea, vomiting, diarrhea because it's farther away from the bowel, but the side effect is lowering the blood count. So to conclude, Bone mets have a lot of different treatments: surgeons, medical oncologists, radiation oncologists, palliative care docs, pain teams. We routinely call our pain team to help manage narcotics and other medicines. Systemic therapy is important, as Carrie was saying, to prevent skeletal-related events. And I'm a little biased, but you guys can feel free to disagree with me. I think when you have localized pain, localized radiation therapy is the best palliative modality. Anywhere from 1 to 14 or 15 treatments is reasonable, probably more if it's a bigger field, or else you'll have more side effects. And I think radiosurgery is an excellent tool to use in the retreatment setting. And then these injectable radioisotopes can be used, but aren't really used that often. Whole bunch.
Yes. All right, wonderful. You guys can hear me okay? Okay. So we have lots of questions, and I apologize if we're not able to get to everyone's, but I also was trying to do what Dr. Parks was doing by trying to categorize some of them, because many of your questions are similar, and some will go to me and some will go to Dr. Zagar. So the first question is, if remodeling is required as part of radiation, do you have to stop Xgeva or Zometa for the radiation therapy to work?
I broke this.
I tried to turn it off, and I broke it. It's a great question. So we actually had a pharmacy student kind of retrospectively look back to see if there was any difference in efficacy of the radiation or any untoward side effects in patients getting Xgeva, and it was a retrospective setting. We didn't see anything. In theory, it makes a lot of sense, but we don't do it, and we don't notice any decrease in pain relief or any increased side effects.
Wonderful. Okay. And there are two here. So how do we feel about proton therapy for bone mets?
Right. So for those of you who don't know, I'm sorry I don't have a good slide to show proton therapy, but if you were to look at the penetration or regular radiation, the radiation that you guys have all had or who's ever had radiation in here, essentially the radiation goes into your body and then over a period of distance, pretend like this is how deep into you, the radiation doesn't go away. It's their so-called exit dose. It just doesn't go away because it needs to deposit and it takes time. So honestly, when you're getting radiation from the front, there's still radiation going out back behind you. Protons available probably at only 10 or 12 sites now, and in fact there was just an article in the New York Times that the first proton center that is actually one of the first proton center ever to close is closing now due to financial reasons. It's the most expensive medical treatment to treat any disease there is. A lot of venture capitalist companies have pioneered these to make money. That said, they do have excellent utility in the use of pediatric malignancies because they deliver dose and then they essentially stop. So if you're treating a beam from somebody's behind and you want to treat the spine, the radiation would stop at the spine and not treat anything in front of it. The simple fact is the protons, there aren't enough proton facilities, and in terms of most of the spots are given to kids with cancer because we think it's better for them. I don't know of a single proton center in this country that would irradiate a bone met.
University.
Really? Was it a re-irradiation?
Pardon me?
Was it your second course radiation? Because that's what I was going to go to that area.
Yeah.
I mean, protons are interesting.
There was one other follow-up. Is cyber surgery the same as proton radiation?
No. So CyberKnife uses photons, which is the normal radiation that everybody's had in this room, not protons.
All right. So there are two here about local therapy for bone metastasis that we've not discussed. So the first one is, I have a TENS unit I was given for muscle pain. Is there any research that shows that TENS is helpful or harmful for bone mets pain? And then a second one is, what are your thoughts regarding an epidural block versus using narcotics for bone metastasis in the spine for pain management? So I think these are both linked in my mind based on sort of, you know, we talked a lot about systemic therapy for bone metastasis, NSAIDs, acetaminophen, narcotics, bisphosphonates, rank ligand, and Dr. Zagar, of course, focused more on the radiation as the local therapy. But I do find if we have exhausted all of our systemic therapies and radiation therapy, many times we will go to blocking nerves that directly innervate the painful lesion, and have found that to be quite helpful. That also alleviates some of the side effects that we have from these very large doses of narcotics. When we do this, though, we usually do it in consultation with our anesthesia service. So many of the centers, and many of you may be aware of in your own centers, an anesthesia pain consultation service. And they're very helpful in trying to determine whether or not this would be a good strategy.
So I think this is a great question.
Okay.
For you.
Oh. So if you...
Because it's fundamental.
I've
asked you this.
Right. So if you start treatment with XGEVA, is Zometa ever prescribed after XGEVA is used? That's a great question. I don't know of a clinical trial that has actually sequenced Zometa and XGEVA, but it's actually a really practically interesting question. I think the answer is, if you start one and want to transition to another, absolutely, you can do that. I don't know if there is an efficacy or improvement in outcome based on that. But I think when I have tended to do this, it's been either based on a logistics issue, a patient of mine who no longer wants to go to the infusion room and wants to get their subcutaneous injection because their therapy is now oral, or if a patient has run into renal insufficiency or kidney problems and we need to transition to XGEVA. So I think the answer is yes, they can be sequenced, but whether or not that's better than doing one for the long term or the other one for the long term, I don't know the answer to that.
And then is there an alternative to Zometa or XGEVA if you have radionecrosis or osteonecrosis?
So that's also a great question. So are there alternatives to Zometa and XGEVA if you have osteonecrosis of the jaw? And unfortunately, I'm not aware of a therapy, a bone-modifying agent that would not continue to exacerbate the problem of ONJ. What we have done is we've worked really closely with our maxillofacial surgeons at UNC, and in some cases have actually prescribed hyperbaric oxygen for healing of the bone. So I think it's really, many times this can be a partnership with a whole other discipline of medicine to be certain that we're meeting patients' needs.
Somebody's just going to hammer out too. So I had radiation to my pubic bone a year ago. My last scan showed more activity in the same area. Can you radiate it again? The answer is yes. But again, you have to worry more about the normal tissue around the pubic bones. You have to worry about the bladder or the small intestine, because you don't want to give them too much dose, because if you give them too much dose, you can put a hole in one of them. And kind of similar to that is if you're not... This follow-up question is, what's the definition of spread or need for treatment change in bone mets? Is it determined by new areas in bones and or change? So it's often determined by new areas in bones, and determining change / progression in bones is probably the hardest site to determine progression. For whatever reason, due to the remodeling, the destruction of the cancer cells to the bone itself, the remodeling changes after the radiation, it's really hard to say. So for the person who said, can we get more treatment to the pubic bone because it's more active on exam, if you're asymptomatic, I would not treat that at all with radiation.
The other thing, just to kind of echo, is that many times if you did a bone scan or a PET scan at different phases after receipt of Zometa or XGEVA, you'll get a different uptake on the scan. So it may very well be that the timing after your last infusion or injection of the medication is influencing the actual uptake on the scan, not necessarily disease activity. So in my practice, when we've seen changes on the scan that may just be intensity but not new lesions, we've forged ahead with the same therapy course. But if we see new lesions, then that is more reassuring that the cancer cells are starting to outsmart their current therapy, and it's time to make a change. So I think that's really important.
Very good question.
Oh, thoughts on exercise, running, walking, weights with bone metastasis. So that's a great question. So I think I think we all are proponents of exercise. I think the issue here would be whether or not there is a lesion that is in one of the weight-bearing bones. So right at the neck of the hip, where the ball of the hip connects with the femur, that's an area that's quite problematic. So I think, you know, many times I always encourage my patients to exercise, and many times before they enter a program, I'm required to fill out a form that says it's okay for my patient to exercise in XYZ program. And what I'll usually do is just go back and look at the films and make certain that there are no problem areas in weight-bearing joints. Okay. Lots of questions. Wow. It's
So are osteoblastic lesions better to have as far as susceptibility to fracture? One would think, I'm not aware of any data to suggest that. Osteoblastic less likely to fracture than osteoplastic.
I'm not aware of that either.
My CT shows new types of both or osteolytic and osteoblastic. Breast cancer is just one of those things. It can do them both. Prostate cancer tends to be more osteoblastic. Can radiation be used to get rid of adhesions that are not from cancer from a surgery? Radiation can actually cause adhesions. So the answer to that is probably not.
So should I be followed by a nuclear bone scan versus a PET CT for diagnosis and following? Sorry, I can't read the rest of this bit, but I think the question is should we be using bone scans or PET scans? And I think we can be using either. I think the caveat to that is that bone scans are better at picking up osteoblastic lesions. So if someone has only osteolytic lesions or predominantly osteolytic lesions, then it's better to probably use either plain films or the PET.
Right. We've had several questions about the utility of PET CT versus nuclear med versus X-rays. And in reality, we often use them in concert together. Living longer with metastatic breast cancer, we can get several RT treatments over time. Do I ever advise not giving radiation for bone pain in patients with chronically low blood counts? I'm trying to think if I've ever had that situation. Depending on the size of the field, I haven't. I haven't been in that situation, but I would. I would definitely consider not radiating if your counts are that low. And the field treated a lot of bone marrow. Just trying to answer all of them.
Oh, we may have gotten to most of them. Let's see.
There's more down here.
I know I ran across one, and I apologize, I can't find it now, but it was a question of whether or not giving these bone-directed agents helped with outcome. And I think there's been an explosion of literature in the early stage breast cancer. And I know my own practice has changed over the past several years. And I actually believe there may be some physiology of these agents improving potentially even what the cancer cells are fighting the cancer cells. And I don't think we understand at a molecular level why that is, but there have been several large studies showing that women who have breast cancer receive their chemotherapy and sort of are in surveillance mode of care. They, in large meta-analysis, have less likelihood of recurrence if they got a bone-directed agent like Zometa. Now, whether or not that will translate into the metastatic setting, I don't know that I have seen that literature, but I think it's something worthy of exploring. And it has to do with the fact that somehow these medicines must be interacting with the cancer cells themselves. I just don't think we're smart enough yet to know how that is happening.
We still have time. Just a couple. The hyperthermia and bone mets. No, that was an old introduction. Mm-hmm. I don't know what the shelf life of Zometa or Xgeva is.
So in terms of how long it actually stays in the bone. I think that's a very good question, and you probably know in some scenarios, Zometa is given every year, and the protective effect is seen over the course of a year. And I've actually personally had a patient in my own practice who does not have metastatic breast cancer who was receiving Zometa for aromatase inhibitor-induced osteopenia, she developed a hip fracture, one of the classic sort of, it's called subtrochanteric femur fracture, which is just above the femoral neck, which is a very unusual place to have a stress fracture. So of course I felt terrible about it and talked with her, and we also went to endocrinology and orthopedics, and it was repaired, but it's really opened my eyes to the negative impacts of overuse of these drugs, or at least being cognizant of how long we should be administering them. And I've started to tailor that a bit in my practice, because maybe monthly is too much for a prolonged period of time, and that kind of goes back to the Zoom study. So I think we're still learning. Yeah.
One last question.
Great.
How am I still alive with bone mets and bone marrow diagnosis? Combination of a lot of things. God, luck, drugs, radiation, chemo. By drugs, I mean chemo. I don't mean illicit substances.
We've already had that conversation today, right? Right. Well, thank you all for your attention, and we really have enjoyed today.